These fine-looking metal pieces are ball screws. They are used into linear motion applications where precision, speed, heavy loads, and endurance are needed. This type of equipment is normally very expensive, therefore not accessible for hobbyists just like myself. Luckily, low-cost alternatives exist, but they might bring other issues into your project. In this video, I will show you how I managed to obtain excellent results using low-cost ball screws on my 3D printer. Before we dive into the world of ball screws, let's understand the difference between a lead screw and a ball screw. And why would you even want to have those ball screws? Lead screws are very simple. They only consist of two parts, a threaded rod and a matching nut. The lead screw will transform a rotation movement into a linear movement via the continuous sliding slope created by the threads of the nut and the screw. In general, lead screws will use a shape of threads called acme. They are also called trapezoidal. These threads are better for power transmission, and they are also stronger. Who says sliding and slope also says friction. Therefore, lead screws require excellent lubrication, not only in quality, but also in interval if you're operating into an open environment. This nut has been printing on my Hypercube Evolution for a period of 6 months. Even with good lubrication, the brass from the nut has suffered from severe wear and erosion due to the considerable weight of the bed from that printer. Lead screw nuts are made from brass. Brass is a lot softer than steel, and it will act as sacrificial material, which means that the nut will take the hit of wear and tear, not the screw. Just as ball screws, lead screws can be back-driven, meaning that when a force great enough to overcome the thread friction and the unpowered motor torque, the nut will transfer that linear force into rotation of the screw. This situation will create your bed from going down when the motors are powered off. The difference with lead screw is that this force required to enter that mode is much greater than the ones you would find on ball screws. The simplicity of lead screw makes them easy to be manufactured into a fairly small form factor. The most popular size for lead screw in the consumer's 3D printing market is 8mm. Being small has the advantage of being flexible. This flexibility will help a lot in case of misaligned installation or even in the case of a screw with axial deviation, or what we call axial runout. Since most obvious 3D printers are made from 3D printed parts, the rigidity of the system will not be able to digest the axial runout of a very rigid screw. They will bend to the required shape more easily, and therefore not winning the rope pulling contest with the rest of the printer's components. In summary, lead screws are simple, therefore low cost. They are also forgiving due to their flexibility. They are also very silent in operation. But on the other hand, they require higher maintenance, they might suffer from a higher degree of wear, and they are also limited into the load capacity they can carry for the same size. Now let's see why ball screws are so special. Ball screws are a lot more complex than lead screws. They consist of a screw with a thread shape made to interface with ball bearings. So far, this is not rocket science. Now let's have a look at the nut. This is where all the magic happens. The ball screw nut contains multiple ball bearings that are used to eliminate the friction between the screw and the nut. As the ball bearings are being carried over by the screw rotating inside the nut, they will eventually need to make an exit at one end of the nut. A ball screw nut is equipped with two plastic inserts. One of these inserts will scrape the exiting ball bearings in order to direct them into the recirculation path. The recirculation path then realigns the balls into the threadway at the opposite end of the nut, using the second plastic insert. This cycle repeats over and over along the screw length, back and forth. Since friction is the number one contributor to wear, you can understand that such a system is not only very durable, but it requires very little maintenance, while being able to carry much higher loads at higher speeds than a lead screw would. For this high-demanding application, I use my favorite lubricant. Category A, pure Canadian maple syrup. I almost got you on this one, right? No, seriously. I use a mix of heavy synthetic oil and this Lucas stabilizer additive into all my linear motion applications. It is a 50-50 mix that benefits from the motor oil fluidity and lubrication performance and from the stickiness of the Lucas additive. Look how sticky this stuff is. It stays on very good to the components and will not turn into hard gunk over time. Although friction seems to be the enemy of all, it is actually helping the printer's heated bed from backdriving its way down when stepper motors are unpowered. It is true that ball screws require very little effort to be backdriven. In the industry, this is usually being addressed with a braking system, but for small and relatively simple machines like our 3D printers, this can be prevented using bigger motors, which have a higher detent torque, or by introducing a higher gearing ratio with geared stepper motors or pulleys and belts. As I mentioned previously, the ball screws are quite complex. Therefore, manufacturing a tiny ball screw assembly while maintaining its quality and accuracy at comparable cost is very difficult. Therefore, most of the ball screws we find on the market are 12 mm in diameter and more. This is a rolled 12 mm ball screw, and we will see in a minute what rolled means. But all that is important right now is that this guy is super rigid. I am applying all the force I can, and it barely flexes. Remember our rope pulling contest from earlier with the printer components? Well, this time around, the printer is not going to win this one. And for that reason, it is very important that the ball screw be as straight as possible. In a nutshell. Oh, I like this one. In a nutshell. Do you get it? Nut, shell. Anyways, a lot of bearings in that shell. But that leaves us with the following summary for ball screws. Ball screws are wear resistant with a very high durability. They require low maintenance and they have a very high load capacity. On the other hand, they are a lot more complex and therefore a lot more expensive. They are not flexible and will not forgive any misalignment into the installation or any defect into the ball screw will never be compensated by the 3D printer. And they will operate with a lot more noise since there is a lot more parts moving inside of them. Before we bring back the lead screws for a decision-making matrix, we need to establish our requirements. Let me first put a few images into your heads before we do so. Music! See where I'm going with this? What if we could do the same with the HevORT? Non-planar printing is getting more and more focus, and the HevORT project does not want to miss that boat. Big thanks to my buddy Mental One for this fantastic display of the HevORT's bed capabilities, and big thanks also to him for all the amazing work he's bringing among the HevORT's community. You'll find a link up here to his YouTube channel. So where were we with our story? Oh yeah, requirements. With the non-planar printing in mind and the fact that the HevORT printing area can be quite large with a heavy bed, my picks would be low maintenance, high durability, and high load capacity. Clearly, this is now pointing us in the direction of ball screws. Let's see if we can deal with the downsides associated to them. As one of the downsides, the noise level. I think we are covered by the fact that many of us are using bird air compressor to cool our parts, and this is much noisier than what a ball screw could be. Higher costs? Yes, but that depends on the precision grade that you are selecting. Ball screws' level of accuracy and precision are usually tagged with a C0 to C10 grade. C0 being the most accurate and C10 the worst. So let's try to source some high quality for our 3D printers. Let's not be too crazy and go conservatively with a C3 or even a C5, perhaps. The price tag associated with these better ball screws made me fall off my chair. This is serious money when you multiply that by the amount of screw you need for a triple Z axis printer. That nice densing is fine, but might not justify that price. In order to achieve the grades C0 to C5, we normally machine them by grinding. A first pass will remove the bulk of what needs to be taken off, and then a precision grinder will remove the remaining in order to achieve the right dimension and right finish. This process requires special tooling and is time consuming, hence the price tag that comes with this. And it will be the same impact on price no matter where you buy them. Even China sells C3 ball screws for a good amount of money. Fortunately, there is another manufacturing process that is able to produce ball screws for much cheaper. This process produces ball screws that are called rolled. The rolling process consists of squeezing a metal piece in between two larger diameter barrels on which the ball screw pattern is imprinted progressively. As the metal rod makes its way between those two giants, it is being crushed to shape. And when I say crushed, I mean it. Listen to this. It sounds like the screw being formed is screaming for its life. Being much faster and less complex, this process will produce screws with two characteristics. First, the screw surface has been cold formed by this crushing process and therefore has been hardened. It is now more resistant to wear and also more rigid. Remember what I told you before about the screw rigidity. The second characteristic is not so positive. Squeezing and crushing the material like this has left a lot of stress into the screw. That stress may even have created permanent deformation that will now affect the accuracy. The runout accuracy seems to be generally the most affected by this. Runout is the axial deviation of the screw compared to the normal axis. I have purchased some very cheap ungraded, yeah, that's right, ungraded, not even C10 grade ball screws, to prove my initial HevORT Z-axis concept. After a few prints, I quickly realized that this was not working. What was happening is that my screws were not straight at all. They were wobbling around their axis, and due to their rigidity, they were also pulling and pushing the build plate. This situation was causing serious Z wobbling that had a pattern matching perfectly the ball screw thread pitch. I made myself a small installation to measure what kind of run out I was getting. This is probably the worst one of all, getting a 1/6 of an inch of variation, which translates to 0.15 mm. Looking at the specification table, a rolled C7 grade ball screw should not have more than 0.014 mm of axis deviation. This means this unit has more than 10 times the allowed amount of deviation that a grade C7 ball screw can have. We could rename this no grade C20, 20 as 20 bucks. Here's another one of the same 12 mm ball screw batch that I bought for cheap money. This one is much better with just under 1/1 of an inch, but still not cutting it for a C7 grade. By looking around, I found multiple articles on the web making mention of ball screw decoupling devices. Some very simple, made of flexible material, and some very complex, involving expensive air bearings. If the industry is ready to spend large amount of money developing air bearing decouplers, this might mean that a better quality ball screw is not always the answer. There had to be a solution available somewhere. I have tried a few solutions that were not fulfilling the job. Because I do not have access to a precise manufacturing tool such as a milling or a lathe, I had to rely on my 3D printer for producing the parts required for my system. This system would have been great, but making the parts out of plastic would not provide the adequate surface finish for smooth operation and would also degrade pretty quickly. Let's get back to basics. We have two parts, one that pushes the other one up. Our problem is that the part providing the thrust is oscillating on a plane perpendicular to the pushing force. On the other hand, the part that needs to consume that thrust has to remain stable on that plane. The pushing up vector is the only movement that needs to be transmitted from our actuator to our carriage. What if I was to imitate the air bearings by using a simple ball bearing inserted between those two parts? We could use small metal discs, such as magnets, for better wear resistance. One of the advantages of using magnets is that the magnetic field will ensure that the balls gets recentered after every deviation move. This way, they will not fall off from the dance floor. Now, because we have our ball screw at the center of the vertical thrust vector, let's use three sandwich assemblies like that one to spread the load around. The ball screw nut will attach to the three bottom magnets, while the upper magnets will be transmitting the force associated to the vertical vector only. The ball screw will be able to wobble as much as it wants without affecting our carriage. Let's print the parts and assemble one unit. This assembly feels awesome. It is holding all together very well thanks to the magnets. But it is also allowing, without much resistance, the two pieces to slide one on top of another. After testing and observing the nut on Z-axis direction changes, I have noticed the ball screw nut tends to rotate with the screw. Although ball screws offer very little friction, it was still enough for the nut to lose a bit of rotation degree momentarily, while the magnets were working their way back to being aligned. I did not want to introduce any hard attachment between the upper and the lower part of my system, so I thought of using more magnets. Magnets are cool anyways, aren't they? By installing two magnets very close and attracting each other could provide additional resistance to rotation. By extending the distance between the rotation axis and the magnets, we are increasing the rotation resistance of our assembly without increasing the resistance to wobble. I have added another pair of those anti-rotation magnets at the opposite side of my system. This would ensure that the increase in wobbling resistance on one side only would not transform into rotation deviation. There it was. The concept of my wobble wings was born. Since I keep referring to the magnets as a dance floor for the ball bearings, why don't we bring back that little music from before? DJ! The wobble wings have definitely helped me in getting great printing results using very low-end ball screws. The print quality, given the amount of runout on those very rigid screws, is very impressive. Wobble wings are a great band-aid, but they will never be as good as high-quality ball screws. Yet, they will allow you to benefit from low-maintenance and high-durability screws for a lot cheaper. I hope you enjoyed this video. I have put quite a bit of effort making it, so if you have not done it yet, I invite you to subscribe to my channel, and don't forget to hit the bell to be notified of new content. If you would like to support my work furthermore, you can donate to the PayPal link into the video description. Thank you for watching, see you soon, and meanwhile, happy printing!